This is Inaccessible Island, and as its name implies, it is one of the least visited and also most remote islands on the entire planet. To visit this British overseas territory, you need to first fly out to Cape Town, South Africa. Then you need to board a ship and stay on it for 7 full days as it journeys 2,800 kilometers to the west-southwest. Eventually, you reach the most remote permanently inhabited island on Earth, a 98 square kilometer active volcanic island known as Tristan da Cunha, population 235. Then, you'd need to be a biologist, some form of scientist, or conservationist, and receive explicit permission to visit the island from the local government, or be part of a tour group granted prior permission to visit Inaccessible Island. Then you would need to somehow land on this remote island by ship, which is made absurdly inaccessible by both its highly rocky and rugged shoreline and its very steep near vertical cliff faces which surround the entire island. If you somehow then managed to climb these cliffs, you would be in the center of this absurdly remote and pristine protected wilderness, which is home to 12,000 of the planet's smallest flightless birds, the Inaccessible Island Rail. Several of the ancestors of these birds likely somehow drifted on debris all the way to Inaccessible Island more than a million years ago, eventually losing their ability to fly over passing generations. But why exactly does this remote island exist, which is surrounded by thousands of kilometers of essentially open deep ocean in all directions? One key point can be found via two sizable submarine ridges that seemingly trail away from Tristan da Cunha and its surrounding islands. To the east is the Wolvis Ridge and to the west is the Rio Grande Rise. Both of these features get progressively younger towards the center of the Atlantic Ocean, and the reason for this is that they both originated from the same underlying mantle plume or hotspot. Known as the Tristan Gough Hotspot throughout the last 130 million years since the opening of the Atlantic Ocean, it has remained and erupted material in close proximity to a mid-ocean ridge that created a new crust, pushing the South American and African continents to the west and east respectively at the same time. Of the three major regional islands, Tristan da Cunha is the youngest, likely having completely formed through volcanic eruptions during the last 1.3 million years. In contrast, the oldest island of the three is referred to as Nightingale Island, 39 kilometers to the south-southwest, and it formed through eruptions spanning the last 18 million years. Inaccessible Island is the middle child of the three, forming via volcanic eruptions dating back to 6 million years ago. Yet, while Nightingale Island produced an absurd phonolite submarine eruption in 2004, and Tristan da Cunha produced a trachyandesite eruption from 1961 to 1962, the volcano that formed Inaccessible Island is extinct, having last erupted approximately 720,000 years ago. All three of these islands are alkali element rich, with erupted materials from Inaccessible Island ranging from basalt to basaltic trachyandesite to trachyte. You might be surprised to learn that unlike many other volcanic island remnants, Inaccessible Island does not represent the former summit of the original stratovolcano. Instead, it represents a portion of its prior middle to lower half of its upper eastern flank, hence why the island has higher topographic features on its western side. The original volcanic summit was once 2 kilometers to the west-southwest, rising to 4,500 feet above sea level, marking the highest point of the originally 10-mile or 16-kilometer-wide island. It appears that a first phase of activity 6 million years ago was followed by a multi-million year gap of little or no eruptive activity, only to then have the main cone building phase occur from 3.5 to 0.72 million years ago. Today, little remains of the original structure of the extinct Inaccessible Island volcano, although I have noted what appear to be the eroded remnants of two satellite cinder cone vents, or at least a magma conduit that once originally led up to them. As a final note, I would like to thank my YouTube channel member Helen S. for supporting my work.